What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other counts I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Yeah. I'm sure I've shared the story before about that song. When I was 5 years old at the Warrington Church of Christ in Pensacola, Florida, they would allow, I guess you could say, the kindergarten kids to lead, the boys to lead a song on Sunday nights. That was always my song. So when I remember that, it makes me feel younger. It's good. Okay. Well, that was a long time ago. I appreciate that very much. This next song, you know, every now and then when I'm about to lead singing, I'll ask my wife, is there a song you want to sing? And she always says this one, and I usually deflect. But today we're going to try it. And we haven't sung this here in a long time, but I know you know it. It's a classic, if you will, a golden oldie. We're only going to sing two verses, so help me out as best you can.
Master, the tempest is raging, the billows are tossing high. The sky is overshadowed with blackness, no shelter or help is nigh. Carest thou not that we perish? How canst thou lie asleep? When each moment so madly is threatening, a brave in the angry deep. The wind and the wave shall obey thy will. Keeps me still. Whether the wrath of the storm tossing, or demons, or men, or whatever it be, no water can swallow the ship where lies the master of ocean and earth and skies. They all shall sweetly obey thy will. Peace be still. Peace be still. They all shall sweetly obey thy will. Peace, peace, be still. Master, the terror is over, the elements sweetly rest. Her sun in the calm lake is mirror, and heaven's within my breast. Linger, O blessed Redeemer, leave me alone no more. And with joy I shall make the blessed harbor, and rest on the blissful shore. The winds and the waves shall obey thy will, peace be still. Whether the wrath of the storm tossing, or demons, or men, or whatever it be, no water can swallow the ship where lies the master of ocean and earth and skies. They all shall sweetly obey thy will. Peace be still, peace be still. They all shall sweetly obey thy will. Peace, peace, peace.
Let's pray together. Almighty God, gracious Father in heaven, we come to you this morning, hearts filled with praise and thanksgiving for your goodness, for your power, for your glory. We see your beauty in nature, especially at this time. Beauty is all around us. Your splendor is amazing to behold. Father, teach us to see you in all these things and to remember who you are, your greatness, and to be humbled before you always, to seek to do your will. We are grateful to serve a God whose power is so great that he can still the tempests, still the seas. And we know that the storms that come into our lives are also able to be eased by your love and by your grace. We pray especially today for the Thomas family. They grieve the loss of our brother Jerry. May you comfort them and hold them up. And may they be sustained by the love of their family. Father, we pray for your guidance in our lives this day and every day, that we will be the light that we should be to those around us, that we will look for opportunities to show the love of Christ to people with whom we come into contact. And may you help us to have the wisdom to know how to deal with the pain and suffering that we see around us, with the needs that we encounter. Father, through this worship today, may you guide us and bless what we do. May our worship be pleasing to you. May it draw us closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
I will be reading Isaiah 41. Verses 10 through 13. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. All who rage against you will surely be ashamed and disgraced. Those who oppose you will be as nothing and perish. Though you search for your enemies, you will not find them. Those who wage war against you will be as nothing at all. For I am the Lord, your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you.
This will be the psalm before our communion together this morning.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In that old stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to part. Sanctify me, so I'll cherish thee, O rugged cross, till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to and exchange it someday for a crown.
I'll be reading from Isaiah 53, beginning in verse 1. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of parched ground, he has no stately form of majesty that we should look upon him, not appearance that we should be attracted to him. He was despised and forsaken of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging we are healed. All of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. Let's give thanks for the bread. Lord, we thank you for this time, for this opportunity we can gather around your table and reflect on the cross, reflect on the sacrifice Christ made for each one of us. Lord, help us to do just that and realize the sacrifice he made for each and every one of us. Help us to partake in a manner pleasing in your sight. Continuing in verse 7, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter and like a sheep that is silent before its shears, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as far as his generation who considered that he was cut out of the land of the living for the transgressions of my people to whom the stroke was due. His grave was assigned with wicked men, yet he was with a rich man in his death, because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. Let us pray. Lord, again, we gather around your table, opportunity to take the fruit of the vine that represents Christ's blood. Help us again to reflect and to rid our minds of the world's troubles, realize the sacrifice he made. In his name we pray. Amen.
Oh, rugged cross, I will ever be true. It's shame.
This concludes the Lord's Supper. We now have an opportunity to give back. There's a basket available in the back for you to place your contribution. There's also opportunity to give online or to mail your contribution here to the building. Let us pray. Lord, we are blessed people, and we thank you for the numerous blessings you shower upon us. Help us to realize that all comes from you. Just ours to be a servant. Help us to be mindful of the needs around us. Lord, help us in that need here at this building, at this church, these people. Lord, we ask you bless the elders and as they administer these funds to those for the needs and to our budget. Lord, we just pray that you give them clarity of thought and wisdom. Again, we just thank you for your love and your blessings. In his name we pray. Amen.
The next two songs we're going to sing together will be before Michael's lesson this morning.
As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people. Surround us, Lord.
Let's all stand together.
I need now under your wings.
Morning. We are coming to an end in the series that we've been doing. And so far we've talked a lot about doing the hard thing, about putting yourself out there and doing the awkward, the difficult, doing it over and over and over again. We've talked about denying yourself and taking up our cross in order to follow Jesus. And in America, Christianity has become something that is comfortable, it's something that is easy, and that's not really what it was ever intended for. It was supposed to be a hard thing. Discipleship is painted in the Bible as being something that is very difficult. It's hard. It's something that we're not always going to want to do day in and day out, but we need to learn how to do it anyway. We keep on being disciples on the good days and the bad days. As you all know, the series that we're doing is based upon David Goggins' book, Can't Hurt Me. And just as a side note, this past week, the Moab 240 was run. It finished on Tuesday. And as the name suggests, the Moab 240 is a 240-mile race through the desert around Moab, Utah. And the winner was someone named Michel Groglia from France. He won in 61 hours, 43 minutes, and 15 seconds. This is a picture of him taking a quick one-minute nap at the side of the road. This is at mile 215, and he decided to take his one-minute nap. He won in 61 hours, 43 minutes, 15 seconds. Second place, David Goggins. He got second. He finished in 63 hours, 21 minutes, and 29 seconds. Now, it was a very obvious second place that he was getting. He was almost 2 hours behind the winner, and third place was pretty far behind him, so he was all alone. It was just him and the guy that was running with him, his pacer. And before this race started, his mom had apparently told him, "You're 45 now. You might want to think about slowing down a little bit. Might want to think about hanging it up." And so in this race, as he's getting ready to finish in second place, there's no one else around him. Nobody's close to him. He's obviously got second. His pacer asked him, how about recovery? How many days are you going to take off to recover? How much time are you going to need to recover before you get back on it? And just to prove his point, he said, I've got 2 miles left. So he stopped and started walking his 2 miles. He says, I'm going to walk this 2 miles. This is my cool down. This is my recovery. Tomorrow, you got a long run. Getting back on it, he was proving a point to his mom, and he posted that on Instagram. Tomorrow, I'm going back out for a long run. Throughout all of these lessons that we've done so far, we've talked about the hard thing, the awkward thing, the difficult thing. The thing we haven't talked about is failure. And the reality is, if we're going to be successful at discipleship, then we will inevitably encounter failure at some point. Because you cannot have success without failure. There will be failure. There will be frustration. You will not get it right every single time. And that's just life. There was a commercial that Michael Jordan did many years ago. As you know, I love Michael Jordan. That's my favorite athlete, so much so I wear his shoes from time to time. But he did this commercial many years ago, and in that commercial he said, I've missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. I've lost almost 300 games. 26 times I've been trusted to take the game-winning shot and missed. I've failed over and over and over again in my life. That is why I succeed. Ask anyone who is successful in whatever field it may be, whatever field they're in, ask them about their success and they will tell you about their failure. They'll tell you about all the failures they've had along the way. Every successful person is very aware of their failures and lots and lots and lots of the failures. And even though we probably all know that, we're aware of that, it's up here, we acknowledge that fact, we don't like failure, do we? We avoid it. We avoid failure altogether. In fact, many of us even fear failure. Many of us fear it so much we don't even want to try. Back in high school, our cross-country coach, we drove him crazy by joking with him. We say, you know, coach, first step to failure is trying. We should just not try. He just wanted to smack us for that. Go out and try your best. I don't know. That is just failure. That's actually the attitude a lot of us have. We fear it so much. In this chapter of the book, David talks about breaking the world record for most pull-ups in 24 hours. And he did it. He broke the record. He set the record at 4,030 pull-ups in 24 hours. But he did it on his third try. The first two didn't go so well. In fact, the first time he did it was on the Today Show. He was trying to raise money for a cause again, and he decided the best way to get publicity was to go on that show. And in the end, it was a really big public embarrassment. Because even though he raised lots of money, all eyes were on him failing. The whole world knew that he had failed, and he tried a second time, and this time it was a bit more low-key. He didn't go on the Today Show. The eyes of millions weren't on him, but he failed again. This time he split his hands open. He went straight from the gym to the ER. And finally, on his third attempt, he made it. And the thing is, there were a whole lot of people telling him the whole time, you can't do it. You cannot do it. They were telling him, you shouldn't do it. And after that first failure, it looked like a lot of those people were vindicated. It looked like they knew what they were talking about. Because they weren't just saying, oh, you can't do it. They were given reasons. He was too heavy, too muscular. You don't have the right body type to be able to do that. His grip was wrong. His approach was wrong. Everything was wrong. And even the people who were on his side, who initially wanted him to succeed, they were telling him to stop. It's too dangerous. He ended up with rhabdomyolysis on one of his attempts. And that's a really bad thing. We won't go into the details of that, but it's dangerous. You can die from that. And he writes in his book, quote, a lot of us surround ourselves with people who speak to our desire for comfort. People who would rather treat the pain of our wounds and prevent further injury then help us callous over them and try again. We need to surround ourselves with people who will tell us what we need to hear, not what we want to hear, but at the same time, not make us feel we're up against the impossible. And I think he is so right. And he goes on later in this chapter and says, it takes great strength to be vulnerable enough to put yourself on the line in public and work towards a dream that feels like it's slipping away. We all have eyeballs on us. Our family and friends are watching. And even if you're surrounded by positive people, they will have ideas about who you are, what you're good at, and how you should focus your energy. That's just human nature. And if you try to break out of their box, you'll get some unsolicited advice that has a way of smothering your aspirations if you let it. Often our people don't mean any harm. Nobody who cares about us actually wants us to get hurt. They want us to be safe, comfortable, and happy, and not have to stare at the floor in a dungeon sifting through shards of our broken bones. People have a habit of telling us to play it safe. Don't go for it. You know, go for it, just not too much, right? Put yourself out there, but don't put yourself out there too far. They don't want you to get hurt. But in discipleship, that is exactly what we have to do. We have to put ourselves out there. We have to go for it. And yes, we will get hurt. It's going to happen. We will get knocked down. We will fail. That's part of it. That is no excuse to not do it in the first place. In fact, quite the opposite. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 12, 9 and 10, "But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong.'" There's something you take away from it. Think about this verse. I've been thinking about this all week. I've been turning this one over and over and over. "For when I am weak, then I am strong." What does he mean? Go home and chew on that. "For when I am weak, then I am strong." Think about that on Monday. "When I am weak, then I am strong." Over and over and over. What's he really mean by that? You know, our failure is actually a good thing. We don't usually view it that way. Failure is not good. Failure is not achieving what you set out to achieve, right? But at the same time, failure allows you to grow. It allows you to learn. And it may be that your failure was a necessary and integral part of building you into the person that God wants you to be. It may be that that failure was a stepping stone. God was saying, you need to be here, but you can't leapfrog. You've got to take those steps. And the failure is those steps to get to where he wants you to be. David says in his book, "In life there is no gift as overlooked or inevitable as failure. I've had quite a few and have learned to relish them, because if you do the forensics, you'll find clues about where to make adjustments and how to eventually accomplish your task." So very true. We don't look at it that way, do we? That's not how we're built to think. We try to avoid failure in our own personal life. We don't want our friends and family to fail. We as a collective society are embarrassed by failure. And when failure happens, most of us don't do the forensics. We don't look for those clues. We get mad. We get embarrassed. We say, man, I shouldn't have even done that in the first place. We decide, well, I guess that's not for me. I failed. I fell flat on my face. And we'd rather just do away with that. We'd rather stay away from it altogether. If I'm going to fail, I'd rather not do it at all. Here's the thing. Has anybody ever sinned? You ever committed a sin before? Hopefully everyone in here is saying yes. Yep, I've sinned. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Sin is failing God. That's what sin is. When you commit a sin, you are failing God. The word sin is the Greek word hamartia. It is literally translated to miss the mark. The idea of hamartia is an archer who sets their eye on a target, takes aim at the target, shoots at the target, and misses. You fail to hit the mark. You fail to do what you were supposed to do. Sin is failure. And there's a passage in the Bible that has terrified me for a long time. I can remember being younger and hearing preachers go over this passage very nonchalantly. They just read through it, sort of passively mentioning it, and it really got to me. Because if you pay close attention to the words, it's not a little thing. It is a very big deal. It is Hebrews 6, 4 through 6. For it is impossible, in the case of those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, and have shared in the Holy Spirit, and have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the powers of the age to come, and then have fallen away, to restore them again to repentance, since they are crucifying once again the Son of God to their own harm and holding Him to contempt. I was terrified of this passage because I was taught, I had heard, that if you sin, it is the same thing as crucifying Christ all over again. If you sin, if you commit one sin, you are putting Him right back up on that cross. You are nailing His hands and His feet. Think about that. You, personally responsible, every time you sin. And think about the message that sends, that if you fail, if you miss the mark, if you mess up, you're responsible for that. That's on you. What's the result of that message? For some, the result is, I can't live up to that. I'm out. That standard's too high. I can't do it. I can't not ever, ever sin again. That's what it means. I'm out. Can't do it. For others, it's a full-out denial that they've ever done anything wrong. If that's what it means, I didn't sin. I didn't do anything wrong. I'm not responsible for that. It's a self-righteousness. It's a holier-than-thou attitude because I can't allow any failure whatsoever, so I'll just excuse it all together. And for some, the message can lead to total stagnation. Afraid to move. Afraid to do anything. And I'll discuss that in just a second. But first, I want to make it abundantly clear that is not what this passage is saying. That message is not what this is saying. This is not the message that this passage is trying to convey, that this writer is trying to convey. The writer of Hebrews is giving something a bit more complex, a whole lot deeper than the message I just said, that I grew up hearing. Should we stay away from sin? Absolutely. Absolutely. Avoid sin. Without a doubt, stay away from sin. Don't go near it. Paul tells Timothy, 1 Timothy 6:11, as for you, O man of God, flee these things. Flee these things. These things as sinful actions. Flee them. Run away from them. Get away. Don't be anywhere near them. He tells him in 2 Timothy 2:22, so flee youthful passions and pursue righteousness. He says in 1 Corinthians 6:18, flee from sexual immorality. Run away, run away, run away. Don't get anywhere near sin. However, our fear of sin, our fear of failing, our desire to be nowhere near it should not lead us into stagnation. You see, even though we're told over and over again to stay away from sin, don't sin, avoid sin, have no part in that sin, we are also told many times we are supposed to be pleasing God, doing the work of God. 1 Thessalonians 2:1-4. For you yourselves know, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain. Though we had already suffered and been shamefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we had boldness in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in the midst of much conflict. For our appeal does not spring from error or impurity or any attempt to deceive, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak. Not to please man, but to please God, tests our hearts. He's saying, look, I'm not doing this to please you. I'm not an apostle to please you. I'm not an evangelist to please you. I didn't go through everything I went through. All the hardness, all the toil, all the trouble, all those persecutions. I didn't do all that to please you. I'm doing this to please God. It's what He called me to do, and that's what I'm going to do. He says in 2 Corinthians 5, 6 through 10, so we are always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. We walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please Him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. The point of all of this is we make it our aim to please Him. Whatever is going on in my life, whatever I'm doing, my aim is to please Him. The question becomes, which one takes priority? Is it fear of sin, or is it our desire and aim to please and serve God? It shouldn't be an either or. Those two things should not be at odds with one another. But for some, because of their fear of failure, those things are at odds. I have known some people in the church, men and women, who frustrated me to no end, because when I'm talking about discipleship, they're saying, no, no, no. Well, you can't do this and you can't do that. The church can't do this and the church can't do that. And the excuse is, it's all sin. It's all sin. The church can't do anything because it'd be a sin, to the point where the church just can't do anything, period. And I won't go into it. It's a lesson for another day. But there's a debate out there concerning our approach to the commands in the Bible. Some believe that if the Bible doesn't explicitly say it's a sin, if the Bible doesn't say, hey, this thing is a sin, it's fine. You can do it. You can do whatever you want as long as it's not specifically called a sin in the Bible. The flip side are those who say, well, the only thing you can do is what's specifically listed in the Bible. Everything's a sin unless the Bible tells you to do it. And I'll tell you right now, both of those positions are actually dangerous. Both ways are very dangerous. And the point is, for a long time, I was getting very frustrated for what seemed to be an attitude of, let's not be disciples. Let's not do discipleship. Let's not do anything because it might be a sin. And I came to realize that what was really taking place was they were so afraid of sin. They were so scared of offending God. They were so scared of failing God, which is a good thing. We should be scared to fail God. But it had actually paralyzed them with fear. It had gone too far. And while their excuse was better safe than sorry, what they ended up doing was putting those two ideas at odds. And they never should have been at odds. Those two things became incompatible. And they shouldn't be. They go together. 2 Timothy 1, 6 and 7, for this reason I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. God did not make you for fear. He does not want you to become paralyzed, stagnant. God knows you're going to mess up. He's very aware of that fact. You're not going to surprise God if you mess up. He knows that from time to time you are going to fail. He knows good and well that you are going to come up short. You are lacking. Just doesn't mean you should stop. He didn't give you a spirit of fear, but of power and love and self-control. So when you fail, God expects you to do the analysis that David talked about in his book. Do the forensics. Look for those clues. Do the hard work and take a good hard look at why you failed in the first place. What went wrong? What did I not do right? How did I fall? How did I stumble? Make the adjustments. Fix the problem. And get back to it. Say, I will not be deterred from being the disciple Christ calls me to be. In our discipleship, failures aren't meant to be final. They're meant to be stepping stones. They're meant to be lessons. They're meant to help us get us to where God wants us to be. Are you where God wants you to be? We close this morning by offering an invitation. If you have not started your walk with Christ by putting Him on in baptism, we offer the opportunity to do that. And if you have, but you find yourself in a place of lot in life that you know you shouldn't be, this invitation is for you as well. If there is something that is in your spiritual life that isn't right, and you're ready to set it right. You're ready to make the change and let Christ start working in you. And this invitation is for you. We're going to sing this invitation song. You can come to the front for whatever need you have. Please come while we stand and sing.
Please pray with me. God, we thank you for this time we've had together this weekend. I appreciate the increasing numbers showing up. Appreciate the lesson we had today, the scriptures that was reading, that was read to us, and Max's observations on it. Pray you'd be with us in the coming week. Please remember, as we pray for Freddie and Max, their knees, Nancy and Judy with the heart, Ashley Etcheverry's father, Marcy Duty, Ashley's father with the, they report from tests, and Marcy Duty in the hip. Especially pray for the for Jerry's family. We thank you for Christ that it. Though one of us died, through Christ, we can live again. It's in His name we pray. Amen.